Hi, I'm Micah Halpern. Thank you for joining me today as I do some thinking out loud. Our first segment is called Background Briefing. The first thing I've been thinking about is COVID and the impact of the coronavirus on our celebration of Rosh Hashanah. On the recent Friday night, I went to synagogue. My name was on the list. That means that the synagogue had plotted out the number of people able to attend within the guidelines of social distancing. Everyone would be wearing a mask, I was told. In our synagogue, I was told everyone must wear a mask. 10 minutes in, I left. I had to leave. Someone walked in without a mask. I wasn't the only one to know this, but I was certainly the only person to look around for an extra mask to give him. There was none to be found. He should have been told that only mask wearers were permitted in the shul. He should have been asked to leave, but he wasn't, and he didn't. Instead, I left. I did. His name wasn't even on the list, just like about 9 other people who just waltzed in, stretching the limits of the social distancing parameters. No one blinked. No one said boo. No one else left. Just me. I packed up my books, my COVID kit, my sanitizing wipes, my surgical gloves, my imitation Purell, and I left. That was not the first time it happened. I have felt compelled to leave a synagogue for lack of compliance on several occasions. When I retell these stories, people ask why the unmasked person was never asked to leave. In normal times, my response would have been chutzpah. What chutzpah of someone to enter a synagogue and not follow the rules? But these are not normal times. COVID is not the norm. And in the age of COVID, a mere chutzpah does not do justice to the danger one causes to others when rules are violated. A friend told me that he sees mask wearing as a measure of a person's ben adam l'chaviro quotient. Ben adam l'chaviro refers to the laws of Judaism that regulate ethical behavior between people. It measures how much respect one person shows towards others, or even if they respect other people at all. Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur are the high holidays. It is a time for community, for family, for prayer. For many Jews, it is the only time that they ever enter a synagogue in the course of a year, or a shtibul, or a temple, or wherever they might go. Or even, for many people who attend synagogue regularly, this Rosh Hashanah may be their first foray back to organized prayer since the pandemic began. And I'm worried for them, for all of us. My brother-in-law, the president of his synagogue, purchased 2 tents to provide for outside services, in addition to 2 services, minyanim, that will be held inside the building. He explained that the organization, the layout, the flow, and the compliance must be smooth and 100% perfect. He said that he and the synagogue have only one chance to prove that their synagogue is safe, that they know how to keep their members safe. Congregants, old and young, who have been in synagogue self-exile since Purim in March, must feel comfortable coming back to synagogue. He needs to prove that their shul really cares not only about spiritual needs, but also, and just as importantly, about physical and health needs. Under the guidance of religious leaders, many synagogues will be altering the traditional Rosh Hashanah service this year, tightening it, so to speak, so as to shorten the time spent in contact with others, but keeping the most essential prayers. In order to reduce the chance of potential contagion, many poems and songs will be cut. Liturgical poems recited during the prayer are called piyutim. One piyut addresses the COVID situation directly. Ironically, it was one of the poems that will probably be cut from most services. This particular medieval poem was composed by Rav Amnon of Mayence and transcribed by Rabbi Kalamanus ben Meshulam. Was famously adapted and put to music beautifully and hauntingly by Leonard Cohen. It is entitled Who by Fire.
And who by fire? Who by water? Who in the sunshine? Who in the nighttime? Who by high ordeal? Who by common trial? Who in your merry, merry month of May, who by very slow decay, who
point, that is, during the High Holidays season, is that your fate is sealed. However, you can change that decree through repentance, prayer, and giving tzedakah, charity. As we do every year, we will hear the sounds of the shofar this Rosh Hashanah. Maimonides, a great rabbi, philosopher, and physician, refers to the shofar as a vehicle used to wake up those who hear it. For him, it was a pre-modern alarm clock. You hear an alarm clock and you wake up from your slumber. You hear the sounds of the shofar and you mend your ways. This Rosh Hashanah, we need to respect others, even if we disagree with them about wearing masks. We need to wear a mask, even if we feel uncomfortable in a mask. We need to be able to tell people that our institutions and our stores and our public spaces are open only to people who respect other people and show that respect by wearing a mask. Every single person knows someone who has died from corona. Everyone, even those who willfully disrespect others, knows someone who died because of this plague. If for no other reason, masks should be worn as a memorial to those who lost their lives in this terrible pandemic, especially on Rosh Hashanah, once you wear a mask. In the COVID era, the words of do or die have taken on new and very literal meaning. May it be a healthy new year for all of us. I've also been thinking about the Palestinians. Suha Arafat, the widow of Yasser Arafat, has come out in favor of the Israel-United Arab Emirates peace deal. Her dear deceased husband, champion of the anti-Israel vitriol and creator of the first leader of the Palestinian Authority, the PLO, and a terrorist, must be rolling over in his grave. But Suha does not seem to care. Mrs. Arafat also apologized to the United Arab Emirates for the disrespect Palestinians have shown the UAE, UAE leaders, and UAE symbols. A widow for over 15 years, Suha Arafat is now coming into her own and forging her own position in the Arab-Palestinian world. She is fearless and undaunted, even when taunted and threatened. Suha did not mention any names, but she did say that while she has received threats and many Palestinians because of her pro-peace deal comments, she has not been threatened by Palestinian President Abbas. On their Instagram account, Suha Arafat posted the following. In the name of all of noble Palestinians, I am apologizing for the UAE people and leadership for their profanation and the burning of their flag in Jerusalem and Palestine, and for insulting the symbols of the beloved UAE. Suha is not by any stretch of the imagination a lover of Israel. In fact, she has a long history of attacking Israel. But this treaty between the UAE and Israel, called the Abraham Accord, is a watershed for her and forward-thinking members of the Arab world. And she is not afraid to acknowledge that this time has moved, that the time is to move on, and the Middle East is not the same region today as it was during her husband's lifetime and tenure when he was Palestinian leader. I was present in the room in Ramallah, less than 10 feet away from Suha Arafat, when the First Lady of the Palestinian Authority told the First Lady of the United States, Hillary Clinton, that Israelis were poisoning Palestinian youth. She went on record saying that Israel was poisoning their wells water and their drinking water. With those statements, Suha Arafat resurrected the medieval canard that Jews took vials of poison and poured them into the water sources, especially into the wells of non-Jews. An obvious untruth. The canard was responsible for centuries of tremendous Jew hatred. It was an untruth then, as it was when Suha invoked that image in 1999. The First Lady of Palestine was born in Jerusalem in 1963 and then lived in the cities of Nablus and Ramallah. Her parents were both very prominent Palestinians. Her mother was one of the most famous early Palestinian activists. The family of Roman Catholics, Suha converted to Sunni Islam only to marry Yasser. The marriage between Yasser and Suha was unconventional in many ways. Certainly, there was a Muslim-Christian divide. There was also an age divide. At the time of the marriage, which was first kept secret from the world, the bride was 27 years old and the groom was 61. The relationship began as a business arrangement. Suha was Arafat's translator and organizer in Paris. Then in Tunisia, Suha followed and served as his private secretary. The two had only one child, a daughter named Sawa. After Arafat's death, Palestinian leadership believed that Suha was privy to the locations and bank accounts of billions of dollars her husband had hidden away, money intended for the public Palestinian coffers that made their way into his personal pockets, Arafat's political heirs promised his widow large sums of money in the form of monthly stipend to help them find the hidden stash. But it became clear that Suha, too, had no idea of where the money is. Palestinian leadership abandoned their promise of money to Suha. Now irrelevant, was relegated to the sidelines. She and her daughter moved to Tunisia, then Paris, and now live in Malta. With the announcement of the Abraham Accord, Suha saw the opportunity to leap from the shadows and jump back into the limelight. She recognized the game changer and spoke her mind, advocating for change on both Egyptian TV and Israeli TV. Advocating for the peace accord between the UAE and Israel demonstrates a true understanding of the region and the roles occupied by both Israel and Palestinians in today's Middle East. Suha is of the belief that more Gulf nations will jump on the peace train. And in fact, the White House announced that Bahrain has also decided to recognize Israel. Arafat's wife learned more from her mother than she did from her husband. There was no love lost between Suha's mother, Ramunda Tawil, and Arafat. Tawil unabashedly challenged Yasser Arafat in the direction in which he was leading the Palestinians. She thought he was misdirected in his political and foreign policy thinking. Some historians have attributed that public disagreement for the marriage between Suha and Yasser Arafat, contending that it was a political rather than romantic love. Arafat co-opted the vocal challenger whose daughter denied both her family and their political leanings by converting to Islam and marrying the mother's nemesis, Yasser Arafat. Suha came forward for a reason. Good for her. She's taking a stand and it is not afraid of its ramifications. It's too early to tell, but at the age of 57, Suha Arafat may be making a play for politics in Palestinian Authority. Coming up next, Points of View. Today, both columns were looking at the deal between Israel and the United Arab Emirates, the peace accord with the Palestinians, one from the New York Times and one from the AFP. And the first column was published in the New York Times on September 8th, 2020, and it's entitled, UAE Israel Fight is Nothing to Celebrate. Subtitled, it's a slap in the face of Palestinians who can no longer count on Arab states for political support. It's authored by Diana Boutou. The paper describes her as a Palestinian lawyer. But at the bottom of the column, the New York Times explains further who she is, writing, Boutou is a lawyer and a former advisor to the negotiating team of the Palestinian Liberation Organization. Actually, she's more than that. Diana Boutou is part of an inner circle of Palestinian leadership, younger Palestinian leadership. The central point of the column is that Palestinians feel abandoned. Boutou suggests the Palestinian leadership change. There is a new reality and they need new direction and leadership. This is how she begins. It's Dateline Haifa, Israel. Last week, an Israeli airliner made its way from Israel to the United Arab Emirates in what was regarded a historical journey. First ever such flight, the direct flight, was the outcome of a deal made last month between the two countries. While Israel and the Trump administration celebrated the moment, Palestinians sounded an opposite note. Palestinian Prime Minister Mahmoud Shatia declared the fight, quote, a clear and blatant violation of the Arab position toward the Arab-Israeli conflict, unquote. We had hoped to see an Emirati plane landing in a liberated Jerusalem, but we live in a difficult Arab era, he said. Now Boutou explains clearly that the deal is a watershed and changes the fundamental rule in place, which was, until now, she says, no progress can be made with Israel until Palestinian issues are first resolved. Of course, that's not true. Why? Because we have a peace treaty with Egypt and a peace treaty with Jordan. Those are examples of how it's untrue. Nonetheless, she writes, and I quote here again, in signing on the deal, the United Arab Emirates shattered a decades-long Arab League policy by normalizing relations with Israel without Israel ending its military rule over Palestinians and without a permanent regional peace treaty, unlike the agreements Israel signed with Egypt and Jordan to return land to those countries. The UAE deal comes at no cost to Israel, which left many baffled as to why the UAE would make such a move. Now Boutou explains the new reality. She says, with Palestinians sidelined, the UAE deal makes it very clear that Palestinians can no longer count on Arab states for political support. Her conclusion includes reforming APA leadership and then move on to a different state, abandoning Oslo, a one-state solution. She writes, I'm under no illusion as to how difficult this transformation will be. Yet, if the aim is to secure Palestinian freedom, continuing on the path delineated by the Oslo Accords will only prolong Palestinian suffering. The Palestinian leadership and the international community must together acknowledge this reality and chart a genuine new course that prioritizes the realization of Palestinian freedom rather than normalizing the denial of freedom. The biggest problem for her suggestion, and this is important, is that the one-state solution Bhutto means is an end to Israel. She does not write about that because it's obvious to her constituents, and because if she did, it would be a turnoff even to the New York Times. Next up is a column from the AFP. It is, as with all of their columns, unsigned. It is entitled, Isolated Palestinians in Search of New Allies. It's subtitled, Analysis, in the wake of Israel's peace deals with the UAE and Bahrain, Palestinians grow closer to regional rogue states such as Iran, Turkey, and Qatar. But experts warn Ramallah and the Gaza Strip might get caught within the regional tensions. It was published on September 12, 2020. The column begins, Palestinians' cause has long cemented ties between Middle East nations with divergent interests, but amid shifting regional alliances, they're increasingly isolated and in need of new friends, analysts say. In the latest blow, Bahrain broke ranks and agreed on Friday to open diplomatic ties with Israel in a deal announced in Washington by President Donald Trump. The analysis in this column is on target. The region is changing fast. The Palestinians are discovering that they are now holding nothing. Palestinian leadership is understandably upset. They have been sidelined. Some suggest and even threaten that the Palestinians should run to the powers in the region. They should run to Iran, run to Turkey. And now the peace continues with an analyst named Khatib. But analyst Khatib argued the Palestinians should keep their distance from Turkey, Iran, and also Qatar, which is deeply at odds with other major Gulf powers. It's not wise for Palestinians to be caught within regional tensions and competition between regional superpowers, he said. If you side with Iran, you'll lose Saudi Arabia. If you side with Turkey, you'll lose someone else. It's better for the Palestinians to keep a safe distance from these different regional superpowers. Khatib is correct. Iran and Turkey will use the Palestinians, but they will not advance their agenda or defend them or their cause. The best path for the Palestinians is to see how this all settles and urge and lobby Arab leaders to advocate on their behalf. Coming up, commentary through cartoons where pictures tell the story. I want to show you four items today. First up is a cartoon from counterpoint.com. It attacks the lack of mainstream media coverage of the Israel-UAE peace accord. The correspondent is doing a stand-up. He says, riots, death, and destruction everywhere you look. Nothing but bad news. And all the while, sitting on his head is a peace stub with the words UAE Israel. It is true, the coverage of this watershed event has been minimal. It's there, but minimal. But there is more to come, believe me. Next up is a funny headline from India. It is a comment on elections, candidates, and their families. The headline reads, Punjab candidate cries after getting only 5 votes, says there are 9 members of his own family. You know there's a problem when you realize that your own family does not support you. Third up is a meme that reminds us of just how different things were last year. It reads, pretty wild how we used to eat cake after someone had blown on it. Good times. Last item up is a meme that comments on our understanding of art, especially Renaissance art, which, of course, emerged after the Dark Ages, a time fraught with plagues and mass death. The meme reads, now that I've lived through an actual plague, I totally understand why Italian Renaissance paintings are full of people laying on couches. In a moment, my own perspective and a few predictions. I recently watched numerous videos of Iranian war games. There were military drills and exercises that took place over 3 days in the Gulf of Oman and the Strait of Hormuz. It covered about 800 square miles. Included were the Iranian Air Force, Navy, and Army. There were jet fighters, drones, helicopters, submarines, and of course, ground forces. Iranian special forces swam and invaded land targets. Surface-to-surface missiles were shot. Surface-to-air missiles were shot. Surface missiles were tested in what was considered real battle conditions. It was impressive. It was meant to impress. The U.S. Fifth Fleet was right there and watching. The U.S. made no action and obviously no comment. Tensions are always high in the area. But now, with Gulf countries waiting in line to recognize Israel, Iran is feeling their dream of a united Muslim world confronting the West crumbling. There is little chance that their dream will reemerge, even at this point in the Muslim world. Sri Lanka donated about 3,500 pounds of tea to victims of the explosion in devastated Beirut. Many domestic workers in Lebanon are Sri Lankan expatriates. Sri Lanka feels close to Lebanon, and they feel their pain. Sri Lanka produces some of the best tea in the world, and they believe that tea has a healing property to it. Their donation was thought, and it was thought through, and it was significant. But instead of going to the victims, the president of Lebanon gave the tea to his family and to the presidential guard and their family. On August 24th, the office of the president Ayoub of Lebanon released a picture showing him with the Sri Lankan ambassador and quoted her as saying that Colombo, that's the capital of Sri Lanka, had donated 1,675 kilos, which is 3,685 pounds, of Ceylon tea to those affected by the Beirut blast. Not everyone was pleased. The tea was sent to the Lebanese, particularly those affected by the explosion. Of course it wasn't a present for those who don't need it, tweeted Paula Yacoubian, a former Lebanese member of parliament who resigned after the blast. She, like many other Lebanese, blamed the explosion and neglect on Lebanese leadership. Chad is a country in Central Africa, Northern Africa, actually. It's a majority Muslim country. Now Chad is considering opening an embassy in Jerusalem. A high-level delegation from Chad visited Jerusalem recently. They met with Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu on Tuesday. During the meeting, Netanyahu said, "I do not only want to mark the relations between our countries, but to promote them even more." This will not be the first time Chad had an embassy in Jerusalem, in Israel, actually. After the Yom Kippur War in 1973, Chad closed their embassy and cut off ties with Israel. They were one of 30 African countries that cut off ties with Israel in 1973. And then in 2018, the president of Chad visited Israel, and Netanyahu visited Chad in 2019. Chad realizes how useful good diplomatic relations and economic relations and tech relations with Israel can be. They will almost certainly open their embassy in Jerusalem sometime soon. First, the UAE, then Kosovo, now Bahrain, and now maybe even Oman. Oman state media issued a statement saying that Oman welcomed Bahrain's decision to normalize relations with Israel and hopes it will contribute to the Israeli-Palestinian peace. In one weekend, from Friday to Sunday, two Arab countries followed the UAE. And earlier in the week, Kosovo, a Muslim country, did the same. That makes three countries in one week. The Bahraini government statement read, "Bahrain hopes this new strategic path taken by some Arab countries will contribute to bringing about a peace based on an end to the Israeli occupation of the Palestinian lands and on establishing an independent Palestinian state with East Jerusalem as its capital." Who can argue? Palestinians do. A few days after UAE-Israel accord was announced on August 13th, Israel's intelligence minister explained that Oman could also formalize ties with the country. Oman has welcomed the UAE and Bahraini decisions, but has not commented on its own prospects for normalization. We've been thinking out loud about a lot today. Now that you know what I've been thinking, let me know what you're thinking. Email me at micah@jbstv.org. Tweet me at Micah Halpern. Let me know what you're thinking. Before we end, let me leave you with one picante piece of information. When speaking about the Palestinians, I thought of the Yiddish word tsuris. In Hebrew, tsurot. This is one word, and it means a lot. It means troubles, worries, aggravation, woes, suffering, grief, heartache. Leo Rostin, in The Joys of Yiddish, said that there is no singular form of tsuris. That's because it never comes as one. The word derives from the Hebrew tsara, which means narrow, a difficult, narrow space that is hard to get out of. It also means shape. The Talmud actually refers to tsurat hapetach, the shape of an entrance or an exit. There is a famous story of the proverbial four women sitting on a porch in the Catskill Hotel. One says, oi, the first woman says. Oy vey, says the second. Oy vey is mir, sighs the third. I thought we weren't going to talk about our children today, snaps the fourth woman. That's tzuris. Thank you for thinking out loud with me, Micah Halpern. Let's think out loud again next week on JBS.